Give us a different intro. Give us like a random sound clip intro and then play the music. Yeah, do it. Surprise us. Make us laugh. Make us cry. He hates these cans.
You know, it's real funny. Sometimes people don't understand that with a lifestyle like mine, partying, getting crazy, it's real important to eat right. Nutrition becomes very, very important. You lose minerals, vitamins. There's nights I feel like a raisin.
Would you look who's back again? Pot of Thunder, episode number 57. I just cracked a fresh Pepsi Max, and I'm ready to go.
Wow.
You guys ready?
Yeah.
Ready to do it?
Ready to rock.
High energy
I'm
today.
I'm staring at the moldy ceiling here in Throat
what
Donut
are you
Studio.
About? Oh, mold?
Never mind. I was thinking of Cobo Hall.
What kind of negativity?
Do it!
Bringing negativity to the beginning of the show.
Drop a couple MF-er bombs, and then it's authentic.
I wish I had the energy that Paul has in that intro clip you played there. You can't tell me that he didn't have a little bit of the nose whiskey going on there.
No, he does never talk about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, he sounds all jacked up in that clip and that whole video.
You know, when I was waiting in line a
Don't
couple weeks ago.
Don't piss on my shoes and tell me it's raining, all right?
A few weeks ago when I was waiting in line to ask Paul a question at the Q&A at the convention,
yeah,
I decided, obviously, on my questions that would sort of benefit Pot of Thunder.
Right.
Asking about a couple of songs. But there was something in me that wanted me to just say, you know what, just ask them if there's, like, any outtakes of, did they improv all the stuff from Exposed? What was their point of reference? Was it, like, an 80s screwball movie? I wanted to know more about Exposed and the comedy element.
Yeah, there's a lot there.
Yeah.
A lot of questions.
Yeah. And so
I think he got sidetracked when that guy compared Paul to the Pope. It really bothered you. I'm
surprised Chris didn't bring that up last episode. I heard,
yeah.
I heard
you know,
I heard that the whole rest
about.
Of the evening.
Oh, it was classic. Guy goes, gets on the mic and he says to Paul, if being in the same, or meeting you is like meeting the Pope, and I happen to be standing right next to Nick, who if you're a new listener or you haven't picked up on it, he literally identifies himself on Facebook as a Roman Catholic. I looked over at that moment, his face fell.
It wasn't that dramatic.
Yes, I was looking right at you. The whole thing was exactly as I expected it. Your face fell, and you just go, "Yeah, not quite." It was funny, man. You got to know Nick.
I don't remember
it
being that. I don't remember it being that dramatic.
You know what makes me laugh about that the most is that Chris said, "Like when Chris first said that, I was like, okay, well, I assumed Nick was just turning his head to Chris and making a comment, but they weren't even near each other.
No, we were."
But I mean,
he wasn't looking at
you
me.
You weren't touching shoulders, and you weren't.
We were close by.
Oh, okay, well, you weren't. Yeah. Well, like what Chris just
well,
said.
I wouldn't have said it to just. I guess maybe I would have said it to
you
just.
You might have
anyone.
Turned your shoulder and been like, not
if it
quite.
Wasn't, if it wasn't Chris, I would have. Not quite, everybody.
Not quite. But no,
you. No, you didn't say it to me.
You would have said it if nobody was there.
Exactly. He was saying it to nobody in particular.
Yeah.
It was funny. It was just. As soon as I heard the word Pope come out of that guy's mouth, I looked over to Nick to see how he would react. That's how, unfortunately, well I know Nick.
I don't remember who the Pope was, but there was a Pope we never got to see.
Yeah.
It was John Paul I, Paul. That's who it was.
I just clicked some video that says, Illuminati Kiss Satan Worship Exposed. That's going to be good.
Yeah, I think his name was Luciano Albini.
Yeah, if you can get past the pregnant broad Toyota commercial.
I've had enough of this woman.
Yeah, what's with this? Why is she pregnant? And why would they
well,
keep
Chris,
her on like that?
I don't know. Well,
okay. We do enough talk about that kind of activity on the show. I think we all know.
Yeah, I don't want to get your Roman Catholic take on it, but it's like the progressive flow broad being pregnant. You know, it's nobody wants to see that.
I don't even know what that is.
What is that? What?
The lady from the progressive
commercials.
Oh, okay, never mind.
Flow.
Yeah,
you know her.
I thought you were talking about like tampons? Incontinence or something.
Progressive flow.
It's like, no, I don't see too many incontinent commercials.
Maybe that's why she's never pregnant, because Aunt Flo is always in town. Or that no man would touch her with a 10-foot pole.
Wow. That could be part of it. But she's got a lot of bread. You got to give her that much. Those Flo commercials.
You know what's kind of hot is that chick in the AT&T commercials. It's like a sales chick at a cell phone store.
She doesn't do it for me.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't even know.
Not at all?
Nah.
I don't know who you're talking about.
But hey, you know, different people, different strokes, different folks.
What sort of celebrity semi or otherwise does get your balls boiling?
I just got into, oh, I don't know about balls boiling. I just got into Mad Men. I think January Jones is very attractive.
And which one is she?
She's the main girl, Betty.
She was in
Don
Draper's. She was in that X-Men movie.
Yeah, she was in
where she was like naked the whole time.
Yeah.
The chick with the gap in her teeth?
No, that's Christina Hendricks, I think, the redheaded one with the huge boobs.
So you like Mad Men, huh?
Don Draper's current wife or
the first one?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you like those Viking women, blonde women.
King,
you're saying? She's like a living, breathing say yeah, basically. Just has a palpable impact on Andy.
Just one of those things.
Warms the heart to see it.
Yep.
It's kind of like being around Nick when somebody trashes the Pope or compares the Pope to a mortal human being. Just it's an instant palpable reaction.
But real quick, I want to go back to something before we get on to the item and the song of the day. We were talking about Exposed for a minute, and I just punched it into Wikipedia. Never looked this up. But it said that there was a follow-up planned, and they shot 5 hours of footage for Exposed 2.
No way.
From the Hot in the Shade tour, but for unknown reasons, it was shelved.
What?
Then it says, the footage leaked to Bootleg Circuit, and it's called Exposed 2.
What?
I've never heard of this.
We got to get our hands
It's
got to
be on YouTube somewhere.
I looked it up. I don't see it.
Okay. All right.
There's one thing that says Exposed Outtakes 22 Minutes. I don't think this is it. No.
Gene's up. Let's go ask him.
That's the same stuff from Exposed.
Now, okay, potheads, we know a lot of you out there.
They're connected.
Are connected. Either find us this bootleg and post it, please, or, you know, you guys may know someone who knows someone. I believe Tommy Thayer is the one who takes care of this kind of thing. Get the word to Tommy. The fans would love
to
see this.
Too bad we didn't know this 2 weeks ago. Nick could have grilled Tommy.
I could have asked him.
Could have backed him up against a wall. And
you know what?
Forced
you see, he looked a little bit worn out. I didn't want to bug him too much.
I think Tommy needs a Tommy. At this point, like Tommy was like their guy, you know, with the Kiss conventions and stuff when Bruce was still in the band. And then when Ace came back, Tommy was like their guy that took care of all this stuff. Now he is Ace. He is Bruce. Tommy needs a Tommy to get all this stuff out to us.
I wonder if he has a Tommy.
Tommy needs a Tommy.
I wonder if he still is the Tommy or if he has a Tommy.
What I'm getting at is I think Tommy needs an Andy. Let's send a resume over.
This fucking guy.
That'd be interesting because Andy something like this Exposed to. He would drive it.
That's something I would sink my teeth into.
He would drive it as far as he can. He'd do an edit.
Well, Andy could take on the project himself. He has like expertise in that area,
right?
Video editing and
Exposed to. All right, somebody out 2015.
Somebody make this happen.
Just get the tapes here. Man. I'll take care of everything.
Awesome. Get the tapes here. Andy's more or less trustworthy. He won't leak them.
Oh, no. It'll be our little secret.
Yeah. Yeah. We run a tight ship over here. I mean, look at all the exclusive merchandise we get that nobody ever sees.
Right. Oh, we have a doozy this week.
Yeah. Well, okay. Well
let's hear about
bust
it.
Bust it out.
Bust it out here.
Not that. Nick just pulled his dork out.
Oh, boy. Bust out my dork.
His dork.
From one of my favorites.
Out of his basketball. One of my pants.
He does have them today.
I do have basketball.
Those are dork pants.
his basketball pants and his Negro League ball cap.
Yeah, he does have a feeling. Kansas City Monarchs.
I'm
is
feeling
that
decidedly black today.
Damn.
Yeah, it's. I have a Kansas City Monarchs hat from the Negro League Baseball Museum in Kansas City.
Did you get some barbecue out there?
I did.
Don't they have like?
What's that supposed to mean?
They had
racist.
He wasn't married yet.
Are you saying all black
I was
eat
well
barbecue?
Married.
I didn't say that. Saying? No, I'm saying that Kansas City's famous for its particular brand of barbecue.
Oh, that's true.
I did hit up a couple of barbecue joints. And Yeah, a couple of really good museums.
But what I was asking about the black people, you're right.
Yeah.
No, I wasn't. Okay. Yeah. You did hit some barbecue joints up?
I did.
Cool. That's cool.
What do you get at there? The span of cope?
I got the burnt ends.
Yeah, that's my favorite at Bombers.
Is that pork or is
they're,
that
they're
beef?
They're always out of brisket when I
they're
call them.
They're out of everything. They got to redo their business model.
Who was telling
man.
Me
Don't
that
get me started.
Someone was telling me, was it Andy?
Probably.
Yeah, that they're
threw a fit.
They're the three Floyds of Northwest Indiana barbecue.
We were talking about that at my birthday.
For those of you who don't know, probably everybody in the world, even like probably German Dan all the way out there, he probably is familiar with three Floyds because I think it's pretty well known, right? It's pretty widespread.
If you're a beer person,
and
I think so.
Yeah, yeah. So Three Floyds Brewery is, you know, very nearby Throat Donut area here, and if they're very well known as being possibly the worst, they say they have the worst service out of any, you know, bar, restaurant, whatever you want to call
it. It doesn't mean they have a bad product. It
no,
just means the service
but
in the
it's,
restaurant.
But everybody, I used to be a somewhat regular over there.
Yeah.
And it just, a lot of people just fell out of it and just said, forget this place.
With the popularity, the service deteriorated drastically.
Well, the thing is that they just, you know, it's basically the soup Nazi approach to business. Like, we do things our way. If you don't like it, get the fuck out.
Yeah.
The wait for a table is an hour, and you have to wait outside. So get out.
And everybody in the party has to be standing outside waiting the entire time.
Right.
And we have really stupid tattoos on our faces.
It's hipsterville over there. Yeah. The thing about this barbecue place in our vicinity is, They limit, I don't know if it's just a dedication to freshness or the, just the size of their smoker, but they make a limited amount of barbecue every day.
Dude, it's the iPhone approach.
And they're fucking out of it, not even at dinner time.
Yeah.
I mean,
you got to get it before it sells out.
There's another barbecue joint opening up, the old Charlie Horse, man. They're going to have to up their game.
Uh-oh.
If they, you know, it's like,
that's good. A little capitalist competition.
You know, at
right
some
there.
Point, you've got to, you know, appease your customer base. And if you're out of fucking food by dinner time, there's a problem.
People are going to be going elsewhere, my friends.
Uh-oh. Are you telling me Ted Turner's setting up shop down the street, getting in the wrestling business?
He's an entertainer.
I love me some Bombers, but the thing is, it's like you get around 4 p.m. and you're like, I don't even know if I should go over there because they're probably going to be out of what I want.
Yeah, that's.
And what I want over there is the burnt ends. They're fucking awesome.
I've never had it because the only times I've ever had the food there, they're out.
Yeah, but yeah, that's kind of, that's a bummer.
I needed to order, I had people over, I needed to order like 4 pulled pork sandwiches. They're like, we have enough for one. I'm like, well, give me the one and then.
I'll cut it into 4 pieces. refused your Andy's wife's catering order for his birthday party. They just said, we don't do that.
They said they wanted
that
more
is that's the
time.
Three Floyds approach.
Yeah, it's like, no, we don't have to take your money. We've got plenty of it.
Yeah, apparently.
I don't know if we discussed this on the show, but quickly it would have been fine if it was just no, we don't do that, but it was like, well, what is it? How much? When is it?
Oh, boy.
It was like so much sighing. I'm like, honestly, well, I don't want to upset you trying to give you money. I'll just call someone else.
Sorry.
It's not a big. Just say no. It's fine.
Go to Hog Haven.
We don't have to sigh at each other over
Hog
the phone.
Haven's just as
well,
good.
Well, they went over to Dickie's. It was pretty
Dickie's
good.
Was good.
Dickie's tears it up.
Anyway, this is a lot of stuff that nobody else out there knows anything about.
Hey,
but
you
whatever.
Know what? People want to hear about burnt ends.
Burnt ends are the shit, man. Well, Nick brought it up.
Well, yeah, I had it over
there. I
like
talking about burnt ends.
You had them in Kansas City. How were they?
At Jack Stacks.
They had been fucking great.
They were fantastic. Jack Stacks. I don't know if it was a steakhouse technically or what it was, but very nice.
Good ass burnt ends.
It was good.
All right, so how does that lead into our piece of merchandise?
Well,
do we have a burnt end from the?
It's something that can go with barbecue. Uh-oh. We got. What do we got?
No, it's just people like yelling outside.
Okay.
I can hear through the window.
Fuck them.
So tell me about the burnt end.
So it's something that could go with barbecue. A lot of people like their different flavored barbecue sauces. You could throw a little honey in there. That's
not
GQ. That's what we're going with this week. We have You know how they, I don't know if you ever heard this, but they say that they have honey that are around from the time, like BC time.
It's like preserved.
And the honey's still good.
Yeah, it doesn't get bad.
So this really isn't that crazy, but I have an exclusive. It's a jar, little jar of honey.
Yeah.
And it's an official Kiss product.
Oh, I see that. Okay.
Yeah, it's right here
mm-hmm.
next to my dork.
And oh, God. I got confused.
Which is Chris on the couch.
Good one.
Yeah. So good one. I got a little jar of honey here. It says 1984.
Ooh.
Is the copyright on it. You see
copyright?
Well, it's copyright.
You copyright honey?
Well, it's an official Kiss product. It's trademarked,
right.
Okay. Copyright.
Let's just slide
over. Yeah, like they're not going to put something out and not, you know, not put the trademark or
good
copyright
point.
On it. So anyway, if you
so
notice.
It's 30 years old.
It's 30 years old. If you notice, I'm going to hold it up to the light here. It's not your typical like golden color. It's got like a blood orange kind of redness to it.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not feeling that.
The reason for that is because
I don't want to put my log in that fireplace.
Especially with all this ant flow talk earlier.
Exactly what I'm getting at.
I'm really turning my stomach.
Now this was an attempt to welcome the new guitar player into the band at this point.
Didn't we get enough of this fuck stick last time?
Well, I put my hand in my bag of random merchandise, and this is what I pulled out this week. So, it's the Mark St. John, the Kiss Mark St. John Angry Bee Honey.
I like it,
which is why it's got the red to it. It's got a little something going on, a little spice.
Okay, and how is this going to reveal this week's song?
Wait, there it is.
Okay,
this one comes off.
Hot in the Shade.
It's called
Boomerang.
Boomerang.
So how did it? What? Wait, there it is. How did it reveal the song?
So
what
Hot
happened?
In the Shade. Boomerang.
Nick's just gonna plow through that.
1989.
He doesn't have an answer for you.
Sorry,
it
Andy.
Happened.
I know you're used to something called Boomerang with Martin Lawrence. And
I've been thinking
one
about
one of your
it.
Favorite movie stars, but this likely will not have a guest appearance by Martin Lawrence. Though
it's
I don't know the song very well, so.
It might.
Well, thank God it didn't predict another song from Animal Eyes. I just couldn't have hung with that, man.
That usually doesn't happen. When it's from the same era, we usually get a completely different.
Well, we did, lineup. However, have a foretelling earlier in the episode. Andy referencing Exposed 2 was footage shot during the Hot
in
the Shade.
Very,
so
yeah.
That's weird how that happens.
Isn't
sometimes.
It?
It's kind of messed up.
Well, speaking of German Dan, this is his album that he loves.
He loves this one.
He's a Hot in the Shade fan. So there you go.
Hmm.
Another four
German Dan.
You gotta say the country and the
Bavarian Dan,
nice.
South African Gary. Boomerang's the closer on this album.
Really?
Yeah. So
there are a lot of cuts on this album.
Yeah,
15.
This is the most. That's the most ever on a Kiss studio album, if I'm not mistaken.
It's gotta be.
Of new material.
Yeah.
Not a, you know, old material compilation kind of thing.
Like Alive or
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, or whatever.
But yeah, I think you're right.
I'm going to say this is the longest Kiss album.
Yeah. I mean,
so who do we got writing credits on this one? I'm not 100% familiar with this song.
Simmons Kulick.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy. What a 1-2 punch.
So this is Gene at the end of the era that he's kind of known for as being a flake, right?
Yeah.
So this is the last song of the...
Of the flake era.
Of the flake Gene era, right before he came out as absolute monster on Revenge.
Well, let me tell you one thing. In Kiss Behind the Mask, there is a quote from Bruce Kulick, and I'll only read you the first sentence from it.
Uh-oh.
But it says, "I think I was high when I wrote it."
Oh, boy.
So there you go.
I don't have high expectations, Mr.
Well,
Kulick.
I don't have high expectations after hearing that, but a Gene song called Boomerang.
When you put it that way.
Lyrically, there's a lot of potential.
When did the movie come out? Early 90s?
Yeah.
Okay, because I was almost hoping it was inspired by the movie, but I think
it was vice versa.
I think the
it's Eddie Murphy. Wasn't it Chris Rock too? Eddie Murphy, Chris Rock,
yeah,
Martin Lawrence.
All-star cast. I think.
Yeah, I never.
When
saw
did that,
that
one come out? When the movie?
I just clicked on a boomerang.
a picture of an actual boomerang on the computer.
1992. I clicked the wrong link. Yeah.
All right. Well, so that's not going to work.
Isn't this movie essentially a template for every Tyler Perry movie that came out afterward?
It could be.
It's like,
well, that's
I don't know.
That would be more of the clumps.
The clumps.
And, yeah, that kind of.
Well, I'm not talking about like getting into character and whatnot. Just the whole like.
You mean
sort
like
of
I can do bad all by myself?
Yeah, kind of? The whole interpersonal dynamic, like, you know, relationships and stuff like that.
Yeah,
good point.
Yeah, I could see that. There was some foot fetish stuff in this movie. I remember that much.
Wow, really?
Flipping through it like 93 or 94 and being like, I don't know what's happening, but I don't like it.
I had a couple of...
You're not down with that.
Well, I was
either,
10. No. I wanted
I had
to laugh.
Well, how do you feel about it now?
I'm not sure.
I honestly had a couple of friends who I think may seriously have been... They developed that complex from this movie.
Damn.
The whole, if the girl's feet ain't nice, then it's no go.
Really?
Honestly, they adopted that as an actual
standard. That's not a bad criteria.
But it's just strange that I think... I'm pretty sure it was they saw this movie and they're like, yeah. It's like...
We had a friend.
I'm not into that now, or I am into that.
Nick and I had a friend way back when who's not our friend anymore from our old band days, but there was never a time where he met a girl where he didn't make a foot comment as soon as she walked away.
Very true.
Every time.
Who is this?
Perfect feet.
Roger?
Yeah. To count the toes.
One, two, okay. Three, four, five.
See that?
Perfect foot.
See, that just ruined it. Yeah. But, you know, that's not a bad criteria.
And then
you'd
be like,
it's not as weird as you think.
Dude, you're all into feet. No, I'm not. I just, if they're bad, it's no good. But if they're good, it doesn't add anything. They just can't be bad.
I don't know. I guess whatever.
It is what it is.
If you have that much coming at you that you can just use that kind of criteria and reject females, then.
Well, yeah.
Then
I mean,
go ahead, I guess.
Obviously, if you want to take it to an extreme, it's kind of stupid. But the actual, you know, having it as a fetish, I mean, in the Spice catalog, in the novelties section, there was a set of fake feet.
I remember that.
You know?
Yep. Just rub them on your wiener.
Yeah, exactly.
Is that
yeah, there was,
their
you know,
feet.
Opening, you know, between the arches and the toes. It was all, you know, just like a rubber pussy, but feet.
That's exactly, you know? It's the same thing.
Yeah, I wish I remember what my description was for it, but yeah, that was a big seller. It was.
Did you get the sales figures for stuff?
We used to go over the sales.
Yeah,
for sure. Yeah.
Did you really over like?
Was it
this?
Ever attributed to your?
No.
Well, Chris's synopsis wasn't that great on this one, so the numbers are taken.
Copywriters never get the credit they deserve.
They probably only get what Nick said. You only get the criticism, but not the credit.
Exactly. But no, after every catalog, we'd go over sales figures, what was working and what was not working. And,
yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
I think the Scorpion Stinger was a consistently good top seller.
I don't know what it is, but it sounds good.
It sounds possibly painful.
Well, that was one where I actually infused some scorpions references.
I would hope so.
You know, it was
by force.
Well, it was a cock ring, I believe, that
Chris is looking to the heavens trying to remember this.
Do it!
I'm trying to remember how to describe it exactly. It was a cock ring that had, you know, a vibe on the top to please a woman, and then the scorpion tail was, you stuck it up your own ass, and it also vibrated.
Wow.
So it was like, yeah, it was a deluxe novelty.
That sounds like
I'm pretty sure...
something for everyone.
Pretty sure my opening line, which is, this is kind of cheesy and obvious, was, this sex toy will rock you like a hurricane.
There you go.
And then, but a little more imaginatively, I closed with, after I described how it works, I said, the resulting orgasm will have you on the verge of a blackout.
That's good.
See, this is... The perfect accessory to cap off a big city night.
There you go, yeah.
If you use this product, you belong in the zoo.
Pull this one out when passion rules the game. All right, let's get to Boomerang.
If you slip it out too fast, there might be some winds of change in the room.
Boy, a boomerang would have made a good sex toy, too. That would have been something good. In the shape of a boomerang. We'll have you coming again and again.
All right.
Anyway,
it's ready to do it.
This one has a lot of good potential with the lyrics, so make sure you get those up in case we have trouble deciphering them.
Let me get rid of this window of boomerang Wikipedia information. Yeah, the movie.
Eddie Murphy with the early 90s African-American grooming trends.
Nice. Dude's got the line in the front. And
real sharp hairline.
Our older brother had that sort of around that time. Kind of had it. They had that was the thing.
The line in the front?
Well, not really the line in the front, but it was kind of, you know, where it would kind of get up a little higher.
The cereal box?
Didn't quite have a cereal box, but there was some elevation.
Good times.
It was that and the little hockey mullet kind of thing was going on.
Those were hot dudes at the time.
Yeah.
Are you ready to do it?
Let's get into it.
89, right? Yeah.
1989.
The last Kiss song of the 80s, right?
Yeah. Let's see how they end the 80s. You guys like that?
I don't know what's going on, man. This is
having like an animalized flash.
Yeah, this
here.
Is coming out swinging, man.
A lot of shit going on.
Yeah, I can't say that I'm too excited about it because, like I said, it's too animalizey for me, and I hated that sound.
I would have guessed that was Paul doing the little ow.
Sounded like him.
Yeah. But I guess
it's Gene.
Gene's things.
Gene was getting his sound effects in order before he dropped him on Domino the next album.
Yeah,
you're right.
But I don't know. Nick seems to be liking it so far.
It's coming out swinging, but I'm a little disoriented. I don't know really what just happened. We had like some kind of cool like tom roll drum
on the Scorpion Stinger just then. That's why you're disoriented.
Yep.
A debilitating orgasm.
I lost my balance just now.
Yeah, you had a boomerang jammed up there. See what happens.
It almost sounds like they just took the same song from last week.
This is Mr. Yeah. Bruce Kulick. So I mean, all over the place.
We heard what Bruce said about it before.
I think I was high.
And he also what he said during the Q&A. I sat there and said, "What do you want? My job is to make you happy."
Yeah.
To whoever's producing the album.
I don't know. So far, not feeling this one. I mean, normally we've sort of praised Hot in the Shade for being better sounding, and also we, of course, love Bruce Kulick on the show, but neither of those things are really coming to pass so far on this one.
And that's interesting because so far it could have something to do with the tempo, because so far it's not too much.
It's muddy shit.
It's not too sonically superior to the song we heard last week.
Yeah. Well. Hey, there's a long way to go. 3 more minutes and 15
seconds.
Oh, yeah. All right. Now, just out of the gate, it's a little too animalizing for me.
Broke through the gate.
In every respect. And it's a Gene song, so I don't know, man. This one's spiraling apart.
It's destined for trouble.
Yep. Yeah, what's he saying? I couldn't make out a word of that.
Gonna throw down the dice on a roll. It's a showdown. Gonna walk on hot coals.
This is so stupid.
Cut the deck. Better place your bet because the game ain't over yet.
This is so stupid.
Yeah, this is pretty weak.
Can I make a bold statement that I don't think any of us have ever made this early on in a song?
Do Uh-oh. It.
This song should not have been allowed to be put on an album.
You think that
I was thinking
was
the same
many?
Thing. It's like they had so many songs you couldn't have cut some of it
because
out.
Because so far this song does not belong in the public arena. The one thing I will point out is, and I'm not necessarily praising it or bashing it, is that we got double bass from Eric Carr the second week in a row.
Dude, it sounds like it's the same drum track. It
could be.
Nah, I know it isn't, but it's like almost the same thing. Nah, I mean, there's like a weird and then he does the double bass beat, but like a weird tom thing that they keep breaking into.
Well, there might be an ultimate irony here. The song's getting away from us. It might come back like a boomerang.
I hope so.
You never know.
Oh, boy.
Let's give it a chance.
You like that?
Yes.
What was that?
I like that line. Get the noose.
That stuttering drum part, and then Gene saying that.
Yeah,
he's really drilling into the bass, too. That kind of jumped out at me at this section. He's really pile-driving into it.
What?
Who the hell is that?
We got a message?
Jesus.
What would that even be? Is that Facebook?
I don't know.
You have so much bullshit up
there. I have no bullshit. This is all necessary to run the show.
It's all...
Oh, that's a lie. You've got your personal accounts up. We always have that damn noise.
Do we always hear it?
Yes.
It's Pot of Thunder.
Hey, all right. let's do a live coverage.
Just leave us alone.
Commenting on our previous episode.
We're recording.
Good.
Leave us alone.
I could
go on a boat ride.
Good, real good.
All right. Get the noose.
Okay, give me the lyrics there again.
The noose.
I'm going to hang.
Get the noose. I know I'm going to hang because you're like a boomerang.
Doesn't tie together at all.
That stinks.
Yeah, this is really, this is one of the worst songs we've had in a while.
This is really exceedingly unstimulating.
None of that even makes sense. Like, I like that he just yells, get the noose. That'd be like cool in an Iron Maiden song or something where it's like about an executioner. But he just yells, get the noose. And then I know I'm going to hang because you're like a boomerang. What does that mean?
It's a perfect example of what Gene did in the 80s. He would rattle off
a bunch of shit.
Really, really uninspired wordplay.
Like going to walk on hot coals.
And sexual connotation to a lot of it. And that was it.
Cut the deck, place your bet.
I mean, and
the game ain't over yet.
I mean, look at any lyric.
That stinks.
Any
awful
lyric that he's singing on the Revenge album. Thank goodness things got better after this.
They're awesome on that. But this is pretty lame.
This is awful.
Yeah, let's just.
I might leave.
He didn't say anything in that verse.
Nothing is happening.
I'll read it to you. He said, on the way up, you change your tune. So pay up, and it ain't too soon. Can't make up or break up. Can't feel a thing. You want a piece of everything. I don't even know what's happening.
Nothing. I'm completely in a vanilla state right now.
I mean, the first part, I'm not going to say it's good.
Nick's a burnt end at this point.
I'm feeling my, never mind.
It's got a burnt end.
My scorpion stinger.
Let me read you a little bit more.
This song is not a scorpion stinger.
No, it's not.
There's no sensation.
The opposite.
No sensation for anybody.
Stinger.
This song isn't even a rubber foot.
No, it's not.
I'm going to read you a little bit more.
It's not even a Phil Goodrich creepy 70s mannequin.
Oh, God. That was in our trunk for like 2 years.
Terrifying.
I'm going to read you a little bit more of what Bruce had to say about the song. Maybe it'll help us understand a little bit more of what's happening.
It'll keep us from listening to any more of it.
That's kind of my idea.
Which is kind of a good thing.
Okay. I had this fancy, fast riff, and I thought, whoa, this is cool. It was like AC/DC on speed. That song was definitely not to Paul's liking. He was against that kind of stuff. I thought that fast double bass drum thing fit for that era. Gene really liked it. Lyrically, Gene had the concept of a song about a girl that keeps coming back to him like a boomerang. As much as Paul hated it, we needed an up-tempo song for the album.
I don't know.
I still say they could have done without this one from what I'm hearing.
Yeah,
so
and, and again, this is I was about to say that this is another one of those tunes that no discernible input from Paul.
Yeah.
So,
you know,
which is never a good thing.
We did talk about how similar this was to Under the Gun from last week. It's not the same, but like a similar speed, similar pace.
Yeah.
Do you think that Paul did that 5 years prior and was like, I don't want to ever do that again. That doesn't work for Kiss, but then they did it again and he was mad about it?
Well, he had, Paul had songs that were of the up-tempo kind of, this kind of feel.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what, he had Exciter.
Right,
that's
but
pretty
I mean,
up-tempo.
At this point in 89, do you think he was like, we tried it, let's not do it anymore?
You think about what, I mean.
We got to do Rise
the,
to it.
Yeah, the opening track, they're putting acoustic slide blues guitar on the album. Like, that kind of makes a statement that they're getting away from the metal, the 80s metal kind of whatever it is that they're doing here.
Maybe that was his thinking, like, we're done with that. Nope.
Yeah, and then I mean, then when you get to Revenge, this does not happen at all. It's a rock album. It's not any of this, whatever you want to call it.
And I do typically like this kind of music. It's just when it's bad, it's bad. When it's good, it's good.
I don't know. The constant double bass, that kind of tempo, it never did it for me.
It's not really Kiss's bag. No, and I mean, last week, last episode, whatever time frame you're listening to these, if anybody's even listening
could be,
at all.
Could be 20 minutes ago.
Is the last one was saved by Paul's lyrics and vocals. You know, this doesn't have that, and it's just going swirling down the drain with a quickness. Yeah. So
it's lyrically the least interesting song I think we've done so far on this podcast.
That's quite an accomplishment because there are a few.
Because there's not even anything where you roll your eyes because it's just embarrassing and childish.
I'm actually hoping.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. There's not even that.
Yeah, you're totally right. I mean, it's not nothing that's even entertaining in its awfulness. It's not even good with that from that standpoint.
You complained about Fits Like a Glove. Wouldn't that be like a godsend right now?
Compared to this.
With
Vinnie Vincent co-writing it, I think there'd be some redeeming qualities. I think he would have done something outrageous on the recording that we would have laughed at.
Plus, there were some, you know, extremely creepy turns of phrase in that song.
Yeah.
You're not getting that, and there's just nothing in this. I mean, it's just like random phrases put together, none of them controversial or anything. This could be the worst song we've featured on this podcast.
I haven't been this upset at a piece of music since we did that Gene Simmons solo album cut that was the two songs merged.
Always Near You, Nowhere to Hide.
I haven't been this upset with the sonic medium.
I think my least favorite was Murder in High Heels still.
That one was not one of my favorites either, that's for sure.
Maybe While the City Sleeps.
Yeah, I don't even remember that one. I mean,
Seduction of the Innocent.
This one is definitely difficult. At the bottom.
It's in the running.
It's way down there.
It's not even out of the gate. It turned around and went there the other way.
It stinks. That's all you can say sometimes. You just have to put it bluntly. It stinks.
I don't have high hopes for a redeeming Bruce Kulick solo. I think it's going to be something like what we heard last
week. Yeah, I'm not.
What about King of Hearts? That was not.
That one wasn't bad.
It was all right.
It was all right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was an interesting song.
It's a Paul.
Yeah, but it wasn't a great one, was it? I don't know. I hope I'm not contradicting what I said.
You're going to upset German Dan, that's for sure.
Sorry, Dan. Love it.
He loves that song.
Disco Dave out there is also a Hot in the Shade fan, but I don't see how anybody could find anything good about this tune.
I love Rise to It.
Well, there's
don't
other good
album.
Songs on this album.
Yeah.
Well,
but this is
Andy's
not
all-time favorite Kiss song, I believe.
Yeah. Or Read My Body.
Or right up there.
That's
yeah.
not all-time, but it's up there.
Yeah. I mean, they just, they didn't need to put this many songs on this album. They should have edited it down. You know? Feel the need to use up every fucking byte of data storage on a compact disc. It's not necessary.
It's a classic, less is more.
Exactly.
I've only seen that work on one album.
What was it?
That was the 40 Ounces to Freedom album, where they just packed it full, and it's mostly killer stuff.
Yeah. I think there's some filler.
Yeah.
I think there's some filler in there.
Very little.
They're playing in Hammond this summer.
I'm going.
Featuring what's Rome is his name,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, the kid's pretty good.
And then who else is playing there this year?
I don't know who else is playing there.
There's
this is the Hammond Indiana Festival. We're getting bigger names nowadays.
There's like a real winter tour. It's like Sugar Ray.
Oh yeah, Sugar Ray is gonna be there this year.
It's like all those bands. It's three of them.
One of the worst bands I've ever seen.
Fucking Smash Mouth.
Yeah. They were a lot better than Sugar Ray.
Yeah,
Sugar Ray is fine. Terrible.
Yeah, they were brutal live. Like, I mean, whether you like them or not on a recording.
I saw Sponge there a few years ago. They were kind of disappointing.
They sucked.
I liked them back in the, when they were out.
They were some ball suckers. here's what it is. Jimmy Cliff.
That's not bad. Yeah.
Big and Rich. Sublime with Rome.
I'll be there at that one.
Under the Sun tour featuring Sugar Ray, Blues Traveler, and Uncle Cracker.
Oh,
well,
God.
Andy had a thing for Uncle Cracker.
Oh,
years
please
ago.
Tell me that's not true.
I have a friend, this guy Joe and I, we just like to reference Uncle Cracker as a punchline. It's not a real thing.
No, that's acceptable. To legitimately like Uncle Cracker,
I'm not
awful.
Those are three bands I will not go see.
It's pretty brutal.
I'll be down with that Jimmy Cliff show.
That's probably the cool one of the bunch.
I'd go see the Sublime.
You'd do that tune. What's that tune he did in that Seagal movie?
I don't know. The harder they come, the harder they fall.
No, he was in Marked for Death.
Come on.
For Christ's sake.
Come on, Pot of Thunder.
Quit blowing up, Pot of
man.
Thunder.
Oh, man. Blowing us up.
People are already throwing out the Scorpions references.
This is another one of those. It's one of those episodes where we're doing everything we can not to listen.
We're talking about Uncle Cracker.
Yeah, that's
to buy us some time.
It is.
Yeah,
just run it.
Just finish this. I like that line.
What was that line?
Yeah, I know I'll get a bang because you're like a boomerang.
Oh, God.
That's like the Live Wire drum beat, just on, without anything cool. So quickly before the solo kicks in, that was almost enjoyable. It was bad, but at least it was like a variation of what was happening. It was a departure from what was happening, which I always appreciate.
No, I like that section more than anything else in the song. Yeah. It's pretty tight musically.
Still utterly idiotic.
Yeah, but are you ready for the solo?
No.
Because you know what? All compliments to Bruce. This one sounds like he's just going bananas like Mark St. John did.
It's a revisit to an era that should have been left behind at this point completely.
Yeah. Well, here we go. Still going. It's still going.
I needed to stop it.
Yeah, Nick's waving his hand at me. What happened? You need a break?
I do need a break from that.
You want to go get some jerky?
You know what that... Okay. What that reminds me of... I don't know if it was every single one of the last Motorhead albums, but maybe the last four or five Motorhead albums, or maybe even more than that. There's a breakdown section in at least one song on the album where there's something with a weird rhythm like that, kind of out of nowhere.
Yeah.
That's what that reminded me of.
Hmm. You know what I was thinking while it was happening?
Except for there's not always a guitar solo going on, so it's kind of disorienting. Cause
that's what I was
going
to say. It's weird for your like kind of offbeat thing, your more bizarre rhythm, to be happening during the guitar solo.
Yeah.
You think you do something a little more straightforward and let the guitar solo speak for itself, but he's soloing over a weird drum beat.
This song has to just...
has to go away.
Yeah, it's...
and not come back like a boomerang.
No, this song is awful.
I was also thinking... that during that solo, Chris has been very critical of certain Eric Carr drumming for being overly busy with his tom work. I think that could qualify as one of those cases. But you know what? There's still more to the solo. Let's hear it.
Oh boy. Oh, shut up.
Was that a reference to
I feel
Step by Step or what? Or what is it? I can't
Full
remember.
House.
Full House.
I feel like someone is having mercy on us because it's finally over.
Yeah,
and the best part of that song for a number of reasons was the ending. yeah. I don't know. I'm just gonna cut right into the voting and
Let's send this one
to Hades.
Do you want to explain why?
It's just way too animalizey for me in every aspect. It's just, I don't know, man. It's this kind of up-tempo, double-bass, speed metal wannabe stuff is just not in their bag. It's not in their wheelhouse. And Bruce is probably the worst playing we've had from him on the show, and we're all big fans. But no, this is going straight down
through a series of hand signals. I was trying to tell Nick that we should both give it a hallelujah to get Chris mad. I can't even do it as a joke.
I'll
go second today and say that even though I typically like the more up tempo stuff, I think the song's pretty bad. And I don't know, maybe if some of it is salvageable, but what they ended up doing with it, the melody of the vocals is terrible. The lyrics suck. The guitar solo stuff doesn't shine at all. It's just garbage that you can't really comprehend. There's nothing good about it. It stinks. It goes straight to hell from me.
If I may revisit a topic from earlier in the episode and kind of use that to illustrate how much I don't like this song.
It's a burnt end.
Hell,
I just like the phrase burnt
end. To paraphrase a definition of hell.
Ugh. Yeah.
Hell is a place where
the devil
the
lives.
Person hell is defined as a place where the presence of the Almighty is not.
Are you telling me that madness reigns there?
Madness must reign. It's the absence of the presence of the Almighty.
So
that's how severe.
Is that like how cold,
hell is defined as?
Is that how like cold is really just the
absence of heat?
Absence of heat.
Whatever. I don't know. What I'm trying to say is, the song is going down. It's terrible.
Yeah,
I mean, there was no redemptive quality. I'm kind of upset. Like we had a listener give us a really nice compliment on the Facebook page a couple weeks ago and suggest that we have people, you know, like, oh, well, you guys, you know, you get some dud songs, and if it's random, you know, you could get some bad ones, a bad streak here, and that's what we're in right now. We've had two, well, I know who Chris voted. Oh, no, did both of you guys vote?
Yeah, we did.
Last time, well.
Paul saved it, man.
Yeah,
there's
well,
no two ways about
I'm
it.
I'm going to go out and say two stinkers in a row. And
Well, here's the good news is we're getting them out of the way, so we have good songs looming on the horizon.
We could be getting these out of the way for the next year
or two.
Yeah,
but on the flip side, if we just went and picked the songs we like, then we'd be stuck with all the crap at the end. That's and very we wouldn't want to finish it out. I know I would.
At least we didn't get this as the last episode. This would have been a rough one to go out on.
Well, that's how they went out in the 80s.
Yeah, well, they definitely went out with flaccid dicks at the end of that decade. This thing is terrible. It's a awful closer.
Real bummer. I bet some people who like the song are screaming at their earbuds right now.
Well, that would be a grand total of two people. German Dan and Disco Dave.
I wonder if even those guys who like this album can really
I'd like
honestly
for th- I would,
say
I'm,
they like this
I'm
song.
I'm calling out to those two specifically to give us your honest opinion of it on Facebook and defend it one way or the other. Yeah.
So you don't think Gene did a good job at all on this?
No.
No. Garbage.
What?
You don't think that like any of the...
Maybe
like
some of that churning bass playing I kind of like, but that's
but about
it.
What about like lyrics?
Oh, hell no.
Bullshit!
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, Gene. That's what your lyrics were. Yeah. Bullshit.
I mean, it was like... rattled off.
Yeah, it's something I would have written in
fifth grade. What the hell are you doing?
Yeah, exactly.
If you had to type something and you couldn't go back and edit and fix anything, this, you know, you'd still come up with something better than this.
You think that he should have said this, maybe?
That's nice for daddy.
You think when he was done writing it, that's how he...
If
he was very satisfied with himself and walked away saying that?
If he said that instead of have mercy...
That's nice for daddy.
That would have been better.
I mean, but like we said, going in, you know, we didn't know, we weren't super familiar with the song, the title Boomerang, and then Gene writing it. There was so much potential there. He just missed it completely.
Talking about nasty feet and stuff.
Yeah, but I mean, likening a woman to some weird Australian implement. I mean, what? There's so much potential there, and he just missed it, blew it.
What was the Indiana Jones adult film?
The Temple of Poon?
It might have been.
I mean, that
comes to mind. Yeah.
But was that... I don't remember now. Damn it. But I remember at work we used to have boomerangs with that. Like they sent those promotional boomerangs with the Indiana Jones movie.
That boy.
Yeah.
Probably That's a better old. Soundtrack than this.
They probably did. I wonder
the
who did
Evan
it.
Evan Stone Band.
Gang Bang.
He could write better lyrics than this.
P.O.T. Pot.
Anyone could write better lyrics than this.
Yeah, this is pretty bad.
Anyone has written better lyrics than this.
You think worst song we've done so far, maybe?
It's up there or up down there or whatever, however you want to look at it.
Yeah, I mean, I really don't want to... go back and compare and contrast the real shitty ones, and like you said, like While the City Sleeps and stuff. I can't even remember how that song goes. You know, that was like in one ear out the other, and this one is gonna be fun. That sounds actually
that
better.
Already sounds way better yeah. than this one.
Yeah, this I. I think I sent that song to hell, but that kind of quasi Aerosmith vibe was still
like
somewhat
it.
Endearing.
You did like
just that.
That
terrible guitar, like a honking on Bobo outtake.
Take me back to my sweet sassafrassy.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that was somewhat endearing. There's none of that on Boomerang. I'm gonna say it's the worst song we've done on here.
Damn. Oh, I know what the worst one
I
is.
I may concur with this. Stop it. That song.
Eighth
was,
Day?
That yeah. was. That song was one of the nicest surprises.
And Nick dug that one.
I still dig that
I can't
that
find
one.
The chorus.
There you go.
It might be better than this song.
Oh,
you're
what?
Right.
Oh, mate. Yeah. That's definitely better
unquestionable.
Than
don't be
I wouldn't say unquestionable.
Don't be ridiculous.
That song is really bad.
Don't be ridiculous, Cousin Dave. I mean, Larry.
Cousin Dave. That's funny. I get it.
I think this is the new winner so far.
It's a stinker. It's hard to say.
New loser.
I don't know.
The biggest loser, if you will.
I'm going to go in on the eighth day, worst one.
Modern TV show that goes with this song, Biggest Loser.
Biggest Loser.
Last week we had Undercover Boss in the discussion.
Yeah, it's shovel some dirt in this one. It's terrible. It's over with.
Barbecue this
never
one,
to be listened to again.
Feed it to the pigs.
This is a burnt end, huh? I don't know. I just like to say
this,
that.
This song burns my end.
This is like Bombers after 6 p.m. Closed for business.
So you're saying Hot in the Shade is like Bombers, but like what track number 12 might have been?
Yeah, Hot in the Shade stayed open too long. They should have closed about 2 tracks.
They had no meat left.
Well, you remember that track 14 is Little Caesar.
Okay, well then. All right, I won't say that.
Was there any
meat
left there?
Yes. Well, we'll get to that, but
11 is The Street Giveth and The Street Taketh Away.
Boy.
Co-written by Tommy Thayer.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
He's got a couple on this album.
We can get biblical
on
that.
Shit, I didn't know he was involved.
Get biblical on that episode too, I guess, huh?
Hell yeah.
Well, right in your wheelhouse.
What is it? Not quite.
Not quite.
Not quite, Chris.
That's the new quote.
That's the new hashtag. Yeah, not quite.
Not quite.
You got to write it twice. Hashtag not quite, not quite.
Classic.
I believe it was only said once. But
yeah, well, you know, the best stories are the ones that get embellished.
There's a lot of embellishment already in this.
Was there a hit?
You don't know that. You weren't looking at you.
You don't know that. You weren't you.
I remember saying it.
Do you
remember saying it, right?
I didn't black out.
He might have.
I wasn't that furious.
You might have had the rage music.
I was looking right at your face. It was fucking hilarious. The whole thing. It couldn't have been scripted any better.
What did he call him? Pope Paul or something?
No, he just said meeting you is like meeting the Pope.
And then Nick's reaction was
the second that word came out of that guy's mouth, I looked over and his face just fell. It's like, yeah, not quite.
What else? What else did he say?
That was pretty much it. But
I thought he said it differently.
He's just, the look on his face is similar to the one that he had on his face throughout listening to Boomerang. Just one of disgust and disappointment.
Was he shaking his head? No.
It couldn't have been that outrageous.
It was bad.
Did he shake his head or did he just look straight at the guy?
He just looked out in the, he was kind of like me looking
spaced
at the
out.
Roof of Cobo Hall. He was just looking at nothing in particular and just comparing Paul to the Pope just kind of took him aback. He wasn't happy with it.
Not quite.
I mean,
not
he quite. Worships not Paul, quite. Obviously, but not that quite. Much.
Not to that level.
Not quite.
Not quite. Love that. That's
I won't
my
even,
new favorite thing.
I won't even do any fact checking on this story. I'll just.
You know, there might be
let it go.
It, in order to do the fact checking, you have to check with me. And I'm telling you, this is how it went down.
And it could be anything.
I'm the only one on earth who witnessed it. from an outside standpoint.
There could have been someone standing on my other side who's listening to this and was like, well, I don't remember it exactly.
No, he only
like
said
that.
Not quite once.
He only said not quite, and he had a bit of a humor about him.
I don't know.
I
believe
Chris.
I
don't know if his face fell completely.
I believe Chris.
Well, that's your
problem. Let's put it this way. The only other person in even remote... The only other person in even remote proximity to us went by the first name of Rocky. So,
damn.
If that individual caught a glimpse of it, we'll have to track him down and get his take on it.
I have to get a hold of that guy and ask him. Not quite. Not quite. I love it. I'm going to start saying that.
Hey.
I got to get it into my regular vocabulary. Yeah.
Not quite. Not quite.
I could see Nick just kind of like blacking out for a
second.
See,
you can picture it.
Totally. I remember it.
Face fell. His eyes glazed over.
I've known Nick for like 20 years.
I always maintain composure.
I can see that. No, I don't know.
Yeah.
When you're conscious, when you're... alert and
well, that's true, but I won't get into that.
Oh boy, what does that mean?
Nothing.
Okay,
so that's true.
Damn.
All right. Well, you guys want to put a bow on it?
Yeah, I think that's it. I'm just the awfulness of this cut has just got
put
me,
a dirty Valle on this one.
Yeah, exactly. Damn, a turd stash.
Stick a scorpion stinger up your ass.
I wouldn't even sing this song in boys' room.
No.
Not even a pair of fake feet could excite me at this point. It's just this one. Just took the wind out of my sails.
You just got to turn on some Morrissey and do a turd stash on the nearest female.
Yeah,
yeah. Exactly. I would rather hear this than Morrissey. I will say that. Yeah.
You know, we're trying to end the show on a nice note, and you just upset a big chunk of the audience.
Well, I'm sorry, everybody who likes Morrissey. I don't.
Okay.
All right.
I will listen to Boomerang.
You take on that.
I'll listen to
Backlash.
I'll listen to the greatest hits of Hot in the Shade Boomerang CD. For 80 minutes.
I don't think that's a thing.
I'll make one.
Okay. That you would prefer that to Morrissey?
Morrissey is just a bad taste in my mouth.
Rubs you the wrong way.
Morrissey. Yeah. But anyway.
All right.
I don't even know his music. Does he even make music or doesn't... Just complains about stuff.
I don't know. You guys are brothers and sideburns. I would think guys like you would stick together. Perfectly manicured sideburns.
Well,
that's true.
Of course, he gives his sideburned rides to dudes. Then again, so do you, probably.
Yeah.
Not quite.
We're going back to the... I was 9, I think, when this song came out. We're going back to that type of insult. The 9-year-old insult.
Never gets old, man.
Heard you're gay.
No, you're gay.
You're right.
I didn't say anything about anybody being gay.
Well, I don't know what kind of activity you'd classify that as, but
sideburn rides.
See, you religious nuts, man. Yeah. You always default to the fucking homophobia. We're not talking about gayness here.
we're just talking about dude-on-dude sideburn rides.
Yeah, it's no big deal.
Yeah,
it's like a side of your head. There's nothing gay about that.
And who knows what the other part of the guy is.
I don't know.
Exactly. Say what the ride is.
Oh, you fucking religious nuts, man. Yeah, you always go straight to it.
I mean, you know, if the episode wasn't over, we'd call Dr. Nick in to figure out what's going on here.
Nick, Dr. Nick doesn't want to come in here after Boomerang. He knows better.
He'd have to clean up an awful mess.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's wrap it up. Thanks for listening. If you like this song, tell us why. Convince us. Tell us what we missed. Because, you know, that's one of the rare ones that gets 3 hells from all of us. So if there's something there, tell us why or what.
Yeah, some guy on Twitter a few weeks ago responded to one of my retweets about the You Make Me Rock Hard episode, declaring that as the worst Kiss song ever. There's no way it's worse than this.
I hope he heard this episode.
So, yeah, make a case for Boomerang if you think you can. We'll slap it down, but give it a shot. We dare you.
I understand saying that's not your bag, but it's not worse than this one.
Yeah, no way. This is. Can we agree that this is the worst one we've done yet?
Yeah, it's not easy. But
as far back as my memory goes, I'm gonna say yeah. I can't think of anything that was worse.
I'm gonna have to say so, man. All the other ones we kind of.
No, this
is better.
That was better? Way better. Way more interesting.
Yeah, brute. Elder stuff better than Boomerang.
Way better.
I guess all of them are better.
The only one that I could think of that was close was that Gene solo cut.
That's this one.
Yeah, that one. But that one's better. That's better than Boomerang.
Oh, yeah. Boomerang is the new bottom of the barrel.
All right.
Well, so much for the random song generator performing better after a week off a couple weeks ago. Piece of shit.
Gotta take it back to the shop.
Yeah.
No bueno. She no start today. All right. Thanks for listening.
scorpion stuff was great.
What was that one song that I told you that I sent you?
Oh,
something about your lover or something.
It's on the CD I have, right?
Yeah,
it's on Taken by Force.
Yeah,
I don't remember. It's not one I listen to very often.
There's some stupid ass name that you probably could have thought of something funny for, but I couldn't remember the name.
Something, it had the word love. Something,
yeah, of course it did.
Feeling your love or inhaling
when
your
passion rules the game.
That's one too.
Song. Yeah.
Passion rules the game.
Yeah, it's terrible. One of the worst songs of all time.
Born to touch your feelings. That's what it is.
That's good. Yeah. We can do it periodically throughout the song.
Damn, what about he's a woman, she's a man? That's pretty messed up.
Yeah, they were a little edgy before they again.
Well, then they
went
the,
into
the Virgin
Strip.
Virgin Killer album was after.
Yeah,
that.
They were some fucking filthy motherfuckers.
They were like kind of like Whitesnake, same kind of stuff. Well, they had the what's the one where the guy's hand is like there's like gum coming off the girl's breast and he's and it's like they're in a limo or
is
something.
It animal magnetism,
maybe.
I think that's gum tits. All right, yeah. That's
right. The sequel to the big
cock guy's album, Gum Tits. It's coming out next year.
The unplugged version?
Yes.
Jesus. Okay. Enough.
Okay.
Enough.
This is good.
Turn it up louder. Shout it, shout it, shout it out loud. Everybody shout it now. Shout it, shout it, shout it out loud.